Excellent. Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the fifth meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public's Appointments Committee in 2024, and indeed only the second time that this committee or its predecessor committee has sat on a leap day. I've received no apologies this morning, and agenda item one is for the committee to take a decision on taking item three in private. Item three will be considering the evidence that we are about to hear from our witnesses today. Are the committee content to take that in private? I'm grateful. And agenda item two is the first evidence session on the issue of committee effectiveness. And the purpose of today's evidence session is to get reflections from former conveners on the effect of committee structures, the balance of work, and making space for innovation for committee effectiveness. And we are joined today by Joanne Lamont, former MSP from 1999 through to 2021, covering sessions 1 to 5, where I think you were convener of probably four committees over that session. And Professor Adam Tompkins, who was MSP between 2016 and 2021 and convened the Justice Committee. Can I say good morning to both of you? And I'd like to hand over to you for perhaps a sort of 5 minutes introduction just on your initial thoughts on committee effectiveness. Joanne, can I come to you first?
Okay. First of all, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm very conscious of my own time as convener and how I felt about people who ran over time and indulged themselves, so feel free to cut me off without any worries about that at all. And also I would say that if there are points that I make that you'd want me to expand on for the committee, I'm more than happy to respond to them in writing at a later stage. I would also give a health warning that I may have a view on how the committees operate, but I guess, like everybody else, I've got my own baggage. I've got my political baggage. I've also got my own history of how I conducted myself in committee. So I'm not always pretending that everything I did was, you know, a model way of behaving in committee. But what I do offer you, I guess, is my experience. I think I would want to underline just how important committees were in the very early days, or how important they were regarded. It was an explanation of why we would have a unicameral parliament. We would have the committees, which would be very strong, that they would have a permanent membership, a membership that was solid, that couldn't be changed at the whim of the parties and so on, and that there would be an emphasis on accountability and responsiveness to what was happening. So there was a seriousness about the committees, and I certainly took the view that the opportunity the committee would provide would be for people external to the Parliament to be able to influence the thinking of the Parliament. You may want to reflect on the extent to which that has been successful or not, but I think the idea that the committee was a place where politics was done differently, where you're testing ideas and arguments as opposed to performing as a politician, I think was something that is worth reflecting on. I think the big challenge for MSPs in this, and it's not an easy thing to resolve, is how you as an MSP, as a committee member, manage all of the bits of yourself that you bring into the room. Nobody can deny their own party affiliation or their political priorities or the priorities of the party in the Parliament at that particular time. But the truth is we have to recognise those tensions, what your constituents might want you to do, what your party might want you to do. But there is a constitutional role in the Parliament that we need to give confidence to MSPs that they can conduct through this process. And at a very minimum, we know, my view very strongly is, committee members should not be whipped. They should not be disciplined for not doing as their the whips within their own party would want them to do. And I think there's a question of confidence of people external to the Parliament to feel that when issues are being considered by the committee, that evidence other than that that you agree with is being heard in a serious way, that written evidence is looked at, that oral evidence follows from the written evidence that has been contributed, and that when witnesses come before committee, it's not simply a job for members to have an argument with the person giving evidence, but to simply to reflect on what they're saying, to challenge, yes, but not simply to continue the normal political arguments through the committee process. So I suppose my questions that I would want this inquiry to answer is, how is the balance of work of the committee resolved. So it is about accountability of the government. It is about running your own inquiries. How many committees have introduced their own legislation, which was held up as an important role before? What balances in terms of the burden of legislative responsibilities, and to what extent is the committee able to respond flexibly? So, for example, you will see at Westminster, we don't always use them as a model, there's a crisis, something happens, somebody comes before committee right away. There are reasons why that can't happen so easily here, but that's maybe something to think about. I think you also have to think about the capacity of MSPs to do their job seriously in committee. And there is a question here, which is maybe just something to flag up, the balance between the power of the executive against MSPs and committees in particular. If a quarter of MSPs are government ministers, what are the implications for the governing party backbenchers filling committee responsibilities? And I think that is something that we need to wrestle with, because parliamentary scrutiny can't simply be about opposition scrutiny. It has a legitimacy if it's all members sitting in a committee across party are arguing something. But if the pressure on government backbenchers, because only half your group can be sitting in committee at all, I think that tilts power balance way too much towards the executive. And I would argue that's probably already too much. And the final point, I guess, I think there are questions around pre-legislative scrutiny, post-legislative scrutiny, being honest about where we got things wrong, having the intellectual curiosity to ask questions that your own party don't want you to ask. But my final point, I guess, is this, that having thought about it, the response, you can't teach or indirect or regulate an MSP to be a responsible committee member. But we should celebrate it and recognise it's a fundamental role, that you come into committee to a job on behalf of our citizens and our communities, not just your own party. And that does mean understanding, managing the tensions in your own roles and responsibilities.
Thank you. Perfect timing. Adam.
One of your challenges today, convener, is going to be to get Joanne and me to disagree with each other, because there's nothing in what Joanne just had to say that I disagree with. Let me say, first of all, that I'm not appearing in front of you as a politician. I'm not a politician anymore. I carry the flag for no political party. Two of you might be upset about that. Three of you might be relieved about that. I have been studying. I was obviously a member of this parliament for a while. Before that, I was an advisor to the House of Lords Constitution Committee for a longer while. So I've got quite a lot of direct professional experience of working in and with parliaments. But I've also been a student of parliaments for 30 years. I teach and write about parliaments. And so most of what I have to say to you this morning, convener, is going to be from that kind of professional perspective rather than any kind of party political perspective. And I hope my evidence will be received in that spirit. And I hope it will be useful. I want to go right back to the beginning, right back to basics. In a parliamentary democracy, parliaments exist to do three things. I mean, of course, first and foremost, they're there to represent their constituents. And Joanne is always very strong about that. I remember her last speech in the chamber when she was giving advice to anyone who was listening, saying, you know, follow your post bag. And I think that's exemplary advice and typical of Joanne. So parliaments exist, of course, to represent people. But within that, they have three functions. The first is to debate issues of public importance facing the nation. The second is to hold the government to account. In this country, we don't elect governments, we elect parliaments, and governments emerge out of and are accountable to parliaments. So parliaments exist to hold governments to account. And of course, thirdly, parliaments exist to make law. You're all lawmakers, you're all legislators. So I think when you think about committee effectiveness, effectiveness is not a freestanding value. Effectiveness to do what? Effectiveness to achieve what? And I think that holding those three different functions of Parliament in mind is a useful way of thinking about measuring effectiveness. Committees don't really have anything to do with the first of those three functions. Committees don't exist to rehearse arguments that should be heard downstairs in the chamber or wherever it is. Yeah, I think downstairs in the chamber, debates about general matters of public policy or affecting the nation. That's not the function of committees. And I agree with what Joanne said, that, you know, anybody who is using a committee meeting to rehearse some kind of, you know, party political debate is misusing that committee. But committees do exist in order to help Parliament with the other two functions. Committees are central in the task of trying to hold the government to account for its policies, for its administration, for its decisions, for its mistakes, for what it gets right as well as for what it gets wrong. Particularly in this Parliament, committees exist to help Parliament make law. In fact, the burden of legislative process in this Parliament is with committees. Stage one and stage two are both things that take place primarily in committee rather than in the chamber, although of course there are stage one debates, but they are debates about a committee report, at least they're supposed to be debates about a committee report. So when we're thinking about the effectiveness of committees, I think we want to be thinking about the effectiveness of committees in terms of helping Parliament to hold ministers to account. And separately, I think we want to be thinking about the effectiveness of committees in terms of helping to make good law. My view, in very general terms, and of course there are exceptions to both of what I'm about to say, but my view in very general terms is that the committees of this Parliament are lousy at helping to hold the government to account. Absolutely lousy. And it is one of the great failings of devolution that we have after 25 years, a Parliament that really doesn't do that job very well, particularly in comparison with what happens down south. I think this Parliament should be proud of its record in terms of making good law. Of course, there are occasionally bad laws that slip through. There are laws that have to be corrected by the Supreme Court, and we can talk about that if you want. But by and large, I think the lawmaking process in this Parliament is really quite impressive. I have one or two specific criticisms to make about it, but they're not particular to committees. But I think the lawmaking process in this Parliament is, broadly speaking, quite impressive, certainly much more impressive than the House of Commons, less impressive than the House of Lords. The House of Lords is the best legislature that we have in the United Kingdom because it doesn't do anything else. It doesn't really spend very much time holding the government to account. It is really just there as a revising chamber for legislation. And some of the things that Joanne said about the absence of party loyalty, or not the absence, but the fact that party loyalty is not so important, the fact that very little is whipped in the House of Lords, certainly committees are not whipped in the House of Lords, just lends that air of being able to kind of think about legislative policy in its own terms rather than always being filtered through or distorted by a party political lens. And when you look at the mistakes that have been corrected by the Supreme Court, if I can put it like that, when you look at the provisions of legislation that have been quashed by the Supreme Court, they've been quashed not really because of any failure of legislative process in this place, but because political will has carried the day in a manner that has allowed legislators to sign into law provisions that go beyond competence or infringe rights or whatever it is. And that, I think, it's not a failure of process, it's a failure of politics. So I hope that's helpful, just in terms of just thinking about what it is we want committees to be effective for. And I'm very gloomy about the prospects of committees in this Parliament being useful in terms of one of those constitutional functions, namely holding the government to account. But I'm really quite optimistic about the other. So a rather mixed picture is the one I would seek to paint.
Thank you. And I think both those introductions are incredibly helpful. And I think just I'm going to suggest that we park the legislative process, in a sense. I hear what you say about it and the concerns that you have, and perhaps others will look at that, because what we want to try and concentrate on, although I know it's sometimes a challenge if you're not going to deal with some of the problems that are thrown up by it, what we want to try and concentrate on is, as I say, that effectiveness of committees. Just before I throw you open to the wolves of the committee for 10 minutes each or so on various questions, I was just going to pick your brain about sort of committee numbers, because it's interesting, again, to look back over the previous five sessions, where we've had 26 committees in the first session, 27 excluding ad hoc committees, 23 in session three, 27 in session four, and 29 in session five. In this session, we have 17 committees. so the workload that falls on a smaller number of committees with, and this is not a political point, but an increasingly large government, a smaller group of backbenchers who can deal with it. It would be helpful to explore your views on that. So, in essence, is there a perfect number of committees? Which presumably the answer is no. But is there something about committee sizes and committee numbers that either stifles or prevents good committee effectiveness, or in fact lends to it? Because the number of members of committees is also something that changes session on session. So we tend to have larger and smaller member committees, whereas previous sessions have had more even, well, odd numbers, but a narrower range of committee members. So I suppose if I come to you first, Joanne, because of your experience of a number of different type committees, does the size of the committee, does the workload the committee's expected to pick up on, have a direct influence on its effectiveness?
Well, I convened a public petitions committee, which is very small membership, hugely effective, precisely because a lot of the dynamics of an ordinary committee didn't apply. The agenda is determined by petitioners. The evidence comes from petitioners, and as a consequence of that, there's, you know, a lot of flu, and people learned how to work together. So it's not always about the size of the committee. It is about the confidence of the membership, about the capacity in certain circumstances to work together. I would say perhaps people should be a bit more relaxed about de Hondt in some areas of committee. If you can get people buying into this, they have a collective responsibility as a committee. Do we really need a 13 members in order to prove that it's all balanced? Because in a normal committee session, we'll all have been there where you've sat through every single person asking their question, when you know you could have halved the number. But that is about confidence of the membership of the parties, to that they don't need an absolute exact replication of the balance of representation. So I think it's about which committee doing which. I think there's another question, which is the extent to which the membership is constant. So the idea that whips can just jump in and out and move you about, I think there should be a default. There's an expectation that if you're going on a committee, you're there for a reasonable length of time. I'm old enough to remember when one party tried to remove their representative from committee and she wouldn't go. Now, that's probably unheard of in recent times, but that idea that your membership of that committee was important, stability was important, people working together was important. And I just say to you on the question of legislation, which I do think you should address, and that is that people have to have confidence that when a committee is looking at legislation, they're not buying into the notion that this is all about good intentions, and we're not. The responsibility of committee is to look at unintended consequence. And if you don't have confidence looking into a committee, that they're hearing from the people who want to talk about the unintended consequences rather than the good intentions, that undermines the confidence in the committee process itself. So I think there needs to be, round size, it should be a bit more relaxed about it being absolutely replicating. You can get why some of the committees that would matter, but it is actually possible if there's enough maturity across the membership that you can have quite small committees that can be hugely effective, because you then have more influence on what's happening during a committee session than you might have otherwise.
Evan, is there anything you want to add?
I think I served on four committees in my time here. I was the deputy convener of the Finance and Constitution Committee for, I think, 4 years. Bruce Crawford was the convener. That had 11 members. And I think that all of the other committees on which I served, including the Justice Committee, which I convened for about 6 months or so, had 9 members. So I don't think I ever sat on a committee that is as small as this with just 5. But I think I would agree, rather boringly, with what Joanne just said. I think that what matters more than size is the commitment of the members of the committee to work together as a committee, to leave as far as they can their party loyalty at the door, and to recognise that they're here to kind of to serve something more than just party. I mean, there's always an extent to which that can't be done. Right? I mean, like, you can't just, you know. But I do think that that's one of the things that does work really well in the House of Commons. And partly it works well in the House of Commons. Stephen Kerr, of course, is a former member of the House of Commons. as is Martin. Is that right? Sorry, I didn't know that. I'm sorry. I do apologise. So you will know more than I do. I've never worked in the House of Commons. But you will know more than I do that one of the things that is different about the House of Commons is that the culture on the committee corridor is very different from the culture in the chamber. And you can be almost sort of two things at once. You can be a party attack dog in the chamber and not behave like that in committees. And I think that that's partly a function of size and it's partly a function of architecture. And it doesn't happen to the same degree in this parliament. People bring their party politics into committees more than they should, I think. And I don't know what the solution to that is. I certainly don't think the solution is having more MSPs.
Just to interrupt on that, but do you think that has been a characteristic of all of the committees from session one? Or is it something that has crept into the Scottish Parliament over the passage of time?
I think it's probably more likely to be the latter than the former. Mm-hmm. I wasn't around at the beginning of devolution, but my recollect, from what I have read, from what I remember, there was quite a collective spirit across the whole of the Parliament about just making the damn thing work, right? That certainly evolved, shall we say, over time. So I think more than numbers, it's the spirit of the committee that matters. And that spirit can be set by the convener and deputy convener, but it's something that every member of a committee is responsible for. And I also think that the point that Joanne made a few minutes ago about longevity of membership is really important. So one of the first committees I was on at the beginning of the last session was the Social Security Committee, which is obviously a new committee at the time because Social Security had only newly been devolved. It was a hot political issue. I mean, welfare reform was a weapon that was being used by the Scottish Government against the UK Government at the time, and the Social Security Committee got caught up in the crosshairs of all of that. But nonetheless, despite all of that, notwithstanding that very overheated, in my view, political climate, that committee made unanimous reports on the Child Poverty Bill and on the Social Security Bill. Its reports on the Child Poverty Bill in particular changed the legislation and changed government policy as a result. And that was, I think, a real moment of triumph for that committee. Why? Because there were members on that committee, including SNP members, who were prepared to work with opposition members to make what was not, perfect legislation, substantially better on child poverty, notwithstanding the fact that there was a big political climate around. This was not an issue which was being debated in an empty room with no members of the public present. This was a big political deal. This had real political salience. But notwithstanding that, that committee managed to work together to make better legislation. And I think that's a really important example of what can be done. Because the members of a committee decide that actually the politics of this is getting in the way. And what we really want to try and do is to have as effective a piece of legislation on child poverty as we can get.
Joanne, I mean, you experienced those first five sessions. Did you feel that the sort of party politics came into committees more from that initial era, sort of session one where you've said, in essence, everyone was desperate to make the unicameral system work, the value of committees. Did you notice that change? Or is it something that's maybe more indicative of certain committees at certain times?
I mean, I wouldn't want to represent what happened in session one as some kind of golden castle on the hill where everybody was hugging each other. And isn't it wonderful? The rebirth of democracy in Scotland is fabulous. It wasn't like that at all. It was a very steep learning curve. It was a parliament born under siege. I mean, you have to remember that we thought everybody really wants this. We came in and people went, and it was just horrendous. So there was a kind of a bit of people coming together. It's also true that people were coming from the thing we learned in this place. There was nowhere to hide. There's no tradition. You couldn't say, well, we don't normally do it that way. What do you mean? We're now deciding now how we're going to do this. And so what you discovered was, and this is something we've lost, I can remember both as a member of the committee and as a government minister, as a government minister, coming in and getting what I would call a right good kicking, I don't think that happens very much now by government backbenchers feel they have a responsibility to protect their minister. There was a queue to give us a hard time, and it was our own people who gave us a hard time first. And I think that's something we've lost and we should go back to in terms of accountability. Also, there was a debate, I can remember very clearly internally, where we were being told, listen, you have to understand, we have a programme of government. Our expectation is you as a committee member have a role in that. And people pushing back and saying, but no, we have this role of independent scrutiny and so on. So that simply captured the fact that there was a tension there. I wondered if I would want people at least to wrestle with these different roles rather than it being kind of accepted that if you're a government backbencher, you're going to be advised what questions should be asked. You'll be advised what outcomes there are. And the best advice I ever gave when I was leader, to my own members, was follow the evidence. If you're following the evidence, you'll not go wrong. If we're introducing legislation that's not going to work, it'd be better to find out now than when we sit in front of the Supreme Court being humiliated. So I think that notion, because there wasn't anywhere to hide, there was no tradition, the danger is that the Parliament has now got traditions round behind which people hide. So I think we just need to go back. I would like to be an assertion of first principles. You have a role as a committee member. This is not a platform. You want a platform for your politics or somewhere else. But fundamentally, you have to ask the hard questions that people don't want asked, but will have an obligation to answer if you're going to produce good policy and good legislation.
Thank you.
Question, Camilla. It's about the changes that have occurred over 25 years. And certainly, Joanne, you're very well placed to offer observations on this. One of the things I struggle with in this Parliament is the level and degree to which parties control everything. They control who's on the committees, they control who speaks in the chamber, they control just about everything. Is that how it was originally? Has that evolved? Has that stranglehold of party business managers, party leaders, has that evolved to what it is now, or was it always like that from the beginning?
I think in truth it was always a tension, and it will always be a tension. There's not any point in pretending that it's not there. People can make their name by being a maverick. There's nothing more annoying than having a maverick kicking about, making you look bad if you're a somebody trying to just do your job. So I think it is always there. I personally think that, and I don't think I got this into the commission that Ken McIntosh, the previous presiding officer, convened, that I think there's an issue about De Haunt being a stranglehold rather than being a kind of a baseline. I think I went and visited, I think it was, we went to visit a parliament in Brussels, and they laughed at us, in fact it was Quebec, they laughed at the idea that government backbenchers would have a right to questions. They thought it was ludicrous because they saw it as being government backbenchers asking patsy questions and you therefore fill up time until people ask the hard questions. Now, I think you have a choice in committee and in the chamber and elsewhere. You either say you're an accountable, responsible MSP, even although you're a government backbencher, and therefore you conduct yourself in that way. If it looks as if you're simply going to do what you're told, then actually you then have to revisit. I think there's too much emphasis. It becomes a burden on the process when you insist that everything's divided up by the nth degree by what people voted for 4 years ago. But there has to be a relaxation around that. So I think the tensions that existed in the very first Parliament are still there. The question is how... I think actually being honest about recognising that balance of responsibility probably makes it easier. But I know that from conversations I've had with people subsequent to my retiring, their frustration that committees could convene and look at legislation without apparently engaging in any way with what was very current for people externally about what that legislation was is a problem for the Parliament. You might not agree with what people are saying about your bit of legislation. You have to give it a space and test the arguments rather than simply a bit too much of dismissing evidence and dismissing witnesses or not calling witnesses actually reinforces the notion that the Parliament maybe is not taking concerns external to the Parliament itself seriously.
I think that's right. So Joanne's absolutely right to say that committees must follow the evidence, but there can be a lot of politics around selecting what the evidence is that comes in front of a committee. And that requires strong leadership from conveners and deputy conveners to ensure that the evidence pool does not get distorted by a desire either to hear one particular thing that is convenient or not to hear one particular thing that is inconvenient to government policy.
The parties themselves appoint the conveners. So that, you know, that in itself is problematic from my perspective.
Well, my caveat to that would be I actually do think I probably on balance support elected conveners, but you need to strip out the government payroll vote if you're going to do it properly. It has to be a backbench vote. Now, as someone who was leader of an opposition party, I can assure you there are very few carrots and even fewer sticks. So you can see from the point of view of leadership in any party, then you want to have some kind of control, you want to have some kind of capacity to determine what your own colleagues are doing. But if you've got elected conveners who are going to be determined, so the strongest party gets to choose who the representatives of other parties are, that's not fair either. And also I think one of the things you may want to wrestle with or look at is the possibility, and again, Ken McIntosh's group just didn't go there, which was around paid convenerships. I can see why they wouldn't. But I personally think the idea that a quarter of all members of this parliament are government ministers is laughable, and really, you know, it's something that should be looked at somewhere. But the notion that there's some kind of progression in terms of your career that is different from that, that you don't have to keep in with your own party leadership because you can build a credibility across the parliament and then get elected to do a job, you can see how different and how attractive that is. So, but that would be around elected conveners. It cannot be that the leadership of any of the parties would direct its own membership at how they would then vote. So that actually would mean you would need to strip out those people who were deemed to be front bench. That becomes complicated in a multi-party system when a small party can have an awful lot of people on their front bench because they're just filling roles, and I think that's a different set of challenges.
Evelyn, can I pass over to you?
Yes, thanks, Convener. And thank you for both joining us again after your initial comments about being away for a long time. I know that must seem quite strange and maybe a wee bit daunting. But thank you for your initial comments so far. I'm interested in what a really effective committee would look like. And from your comments previously, obviously, maybe some committees are more effective than others. But what's a recipe for a really good, strong committee, strong on scrutiny, strong on holding the government to account? What does it look like?
I don't think there's a one-size-fits-all answer to that question. I really don't. So, the plural of anecdote is not data, but I'm just going to give you a couple of anecdotes from my experience, right? I was on the COVID-19 committee from when it was set up in the summer, early summer, late spring, whenever it was, of 2020, during lockdown, until I became convener of the Justice Committee. And what that committee needed to do is entirely different from what the Justice Committee needed to do. So to judge the effectiveness of the COVID-19 committee, you'd be looking at very different metrics from what you would look at if you were judging the effectiveness of the Justice Committee. And there's lots of reasons for that, but the most important one is that the COVID-19 committee, by and large, was not considering primary legislation. It was considering lockdown regulations, but it wasn't considering primary legislation, whereas the Justice Committee was doing hardly anything other than considering primary legislation. I was only convener of Justice for 6 months, but in those 6 months, we did three bills from beginning to end, stage one, stage two, and obviously stage three. But and one of those bills was incredibly controversial and required a lot of committee time, a lot of parliamentary time, the Hate Crime Bill, Hate Crime Act, as it now is. And so, you know, just I would just need to break that question down into the different components, as I said at the beginning, of what it is that committees are here to do, and that they're not all here to do the same thing. The Finance and Constitution Committee, as it was when I served here, the most important thing that the Finance Committee dealt with was the budget. And the budget is, of course, legislation, but it's not normal legislation. And most of the time you're dealing with, with fiscal policy in the Finance Committee. And what makes a Finance Committee effective might be very different, again, from what makes a COVID-19 committee or a Justice Committee effective. So I think it depends. It's not a very helpful answer, but I'm afraid it's the only answer I can give. The answer to your question is it really depends on what committee you're talking about, and it isn't one size fits all.
Okay, Joanne?
Yeah. I mean, you said it may be daunting for somebody who's retired and spent my life shouting at the telly and not being attended. It's quite nice to come somewhere where potentially something I say might have some influence on anything at all. A good committee is efficient, it's serious, so we don't have the kind of performative, setting up gotcha moments against witnesses and all that kind of thing. Serious, professional, where all members are engaged. I'd be interested if you took a wee snapshot of some committees where folk are on their phones and are not engaged, are not asking questions, are not the people who are really... They're there, and there's going to be trouble and there's going to be a vote. I also think you can test a committee by how they... I'm talking about being respectful to witnesses. I actually think in terms of government ministers, although I didn't like getting kicked about the room, it didn't have concentrate your mind because it meant, well, I'm not going back in there, I'm not going to have that happen to me again. So that kind of robust accountability, that tough questioning, the holding somebody properly to account for their responsibilities, I think I would make an exception for government ministers but not government officials. I think they have to be treated differently. So, and purposeful. So there's an outcome, there's a sense of... it's not just, well, we've got to fill up this time because we're here, but when we're not, so there is carving out time for serious pre-legislative work, post-legislative work. If I had an observation about my time in the Parliament, too much of it became sending messages rather than being accountable for delivery. Like, we can all hold up a poster. I was as good as anybody else at doing. It's not any substitute for substantial policy making where you can actually reach out and touch. That's where the differences were made in communities. I think if the committees have got that focus, that can help. I would now, the Public Petitions Committee is different, and I would put in here that I'm concerned that its remit has been broadened to somehow be the committee responsible for civic participation. That should be a matter for all committees. If the Public Petitions Committee is only taking petitions, it's doing a very, very good job. And that's precious and that should be held on to. But it's a good example of a committee that's entirely driven by the agenda external to the committee. And I think that, that rigour is a good... If you wanted to look at a model for how people work together, where their focus is not but what you bring in, but what other people bring in is a good example. I should also say that good committees... are at their best when they're well served by their clerks, and it's probably a resource that people have not acknowledged sufficiently. A good quality clerking team, properly resourced, can mean that your professionalism, when your role asking questions in a stage one inquiry, is very different from another kind of inquiry, because you have to ask witnesses all the same questions, make sure areas are covered. And I think that would again... A good committee will be well resourced by proper clerking time, and it might be something the committee might want to, I don't know how they would do this, but engage with the clerking process about the extent to which it feels it's properly resourced as well.
Thank you for that. And in a similar vein, inquiries. What does a good inquiry look like, and how do we make sure that there's good outcomes from those inquiries?
That's a really good question. The power that committees have is the power to take evidence, right? So, call in people whose voices are not normally heard in the budget process or in the context of, making criminal justice legislation or in whatever the context is. But the effectiveness of a committee is what it does with the evidence. that it garners. And the point that Joanne and I both keep coming back to, that the courage of committee members to follow the evidence rather than to follow the party line, because we're all going to meet evidence that makes our party line a little bit uncomfortable. Right. So what do we do with that? You know, and so what makes a good inquiry is a group of people sitting around the table week in, week out for some number of weeks, focused on the evidence and on what they want to do with the evidence in the interests of the committee, the parliament and the public, rather than in the interests of the party line, I think is the key thing. And, you know, as I said, in my introductory remarks, I think that there are really quite remarkably good examples of this parliament doing that well, doing that job well, even in contexts which are very highly charged in terms of like partisan rough and tumble. And the early work of the Social Security Committee would be a good example of that. I think I hope that the work that I convened when I was the convener of the Justice Committee is another example of that, but that's not for me to say. So I don't think that, you know, committees can't work well when they're dealing with a matter which is very highly charged as a kind of partisan matter in the heat of the moment. I don't think that at all. But I do think that the real power that a committee has is to determine who they want to hear from. And the test of a committee is the extent to which, having heard from the people that they've heard from, they really are following the evidence rather than allowing that evidence to be filtered through, that is to say, corrupted by the party line.
I would say that one of the things that struck us in the early days of the Parliament, where there was a legislative lag, if you like, legislation that was required, but it wasn't possible for the House of Commons to get through. There was a whole load of things around mental health, around learning disability, around education and others, where people were sitting ready to be asked. So a good inquiry knows where there are people with expertise, and it's not just the experts and the friends of the committee, and that's another area that would be worth looking at. And I know the conveners group did this at one point, looking at who's called to evidence by sex, by geography, by professionalism. And I know that, for example, calling for evidence from people who are wholly funded by the Scottish Government, then their evidence should be regarded in a different way from somebody who's a volunteer group. So that's something that might be worth just putting into the system. That, and I know that people have argued for this, that if you're coming before committee and you're funded by the government, then that should be obvious. There are a couple of really good examples, I think, of inquiries in the Scottish Parliament in very early days around the contamination of blood. Actually, at a Westminster UK level, they're probably now catching up with something that was, you know, compensation schemes and stuff that were being discussed in the first Parliament, when the then Health Minister, I think Malcolm Chisholm, was saying, I can't stand in the face of this. You know, something has to be done. This is a scandal. And another good example, and it's probably still working its way through the system, it started off in the Public Petitions Committee, a great place to look for good inquiries that could be pursued, was the whole question of mesh and the way in which women were treated, because it was an issue that when people came in contact with it, and, you know, across party, I'm very proud of MSP colleagues who said, this cannot go on, and pursued over a long period of time. And I suppose the feature of it was, these are not inquiries created in committee rooms by MSPs, but it's what the system, you know, what externally. Now, I would argue if you're a good MSP, you're picking that up in your surgeries and so on. That to me, a good inquiry is not something dreamt up in here, but emerges out of people who already say this is an issue we want you to look at in detail. And a related issue to that, which is maybe the extent to which MSPs themselves know that they can attend other committees and are welcome to attend. The Public Petitions, another good example, where there was petitions that there was a general interest in, and we had a facility to ensure that other members could come along and ask questions. So, and I think that's something that ought to be encouraged if you want a kind of an energy round the deliberations of the committee. You want just this kind of process. It's a Wednesday morning, so I'm going to go along and look concerned about X. it drives more energy into the process, if that's acknowledged as well.
Thanks for that. Also, what are your views on pre- and post-legislative scrutiny? Because, I mean, I'm a reasonably new MSP, but I see a lot of pre-scrutiny. I haven't seen a lot of post-scrutiny. What's your kind of view on maybe the balance of that? You know, do you think we should have more post-scrutiny?
High quality pre-legislative scrutiny would mean that the post-legislative scrutiny, easy for me to say, would be a lot happier process. And I'm not. I mean, a question I would ask again is the extent to which, ahead of stage one consideration of a bill, for example, is there serious pre-legislative scrutiny by committee? Because it seemed back in the day that it was something that took up a lot of time. Ahead of a bill being published, there was work done by committee. And I know various committees of the Parliament, including, I think, the Audit Committee, again highlighted the need for post-leg. It would be quite good to know that legislation that everybody celebrates as sending a signal actually made a difference, to repeat myself from earlier, and a bit of post-legislative study, rather than just, oh, well, it ended up in the Supreme Court, that didn't go well. It would be good to know what has worked well and learn lessons from it. But I think that's a process. You need to think about how that process is managed, and everybody says it's a good thing. I don't think anybody's ever quite got to the place where they've worked out how you would do it in a kind of serious way.
That's right. So the post-legislative scrutiny is one of those things that you know, people like the Hansard Society, people like the Study of Parliament Group, they're always saying Parliament needs more post-legislative scrutiny, and it is a kind of mantra in the scholarship and in the literature. I don't know of a parliament anywhere in the world that does post-legislative scrutiny particularly well. I don't think this parliament does it particularly badly in comparison with any other parliament, because I don't think any parliament does it particularly well, because, I don't need to tell you this room, the agenda moves on, right? And politics is always about what's next and never about what happened, you know, two or three years ago. So I think that, you know, chasing after world-class post-legislative scrutiny might be a bit of a chimera. Not to say that we shouldn't nonetheless chase after it, but it might be one of those aspirations that's never reached. Pre-legislative scrutiny, I think, matters much more. And the reason why I think it matters much more is because, you know, parliamentary scrutiny of government policy is at its most effective when the government is not too deeply dug in, right? And you can have really good pre-legislative scrutiny in this parliament even when there's no formal stage of it, if the minister proposing the bill comes to the committee and says, this is work in progress. There might be things here that we haven't quite got right. And I'll give you an example of where that went well, and it was the way in which Jean Freeman handled the Social Security Bill. Right? When Jean Freeman came to the Social Security Committee with the Social Security Bill, she opened the door to all parties. All five parties were represented in that committee, and all of us were invited to talk to her about what was good, bad, and ugly in that legislation. It wasn't much that was ugly in it. What was good and bad in that legislation? And the atmosphere of the way in which that committee was able to do its early deliberation on what became the Social Security Act was kind of pre-legislative, and that wasn't anything formal or anything structural. It was the way in which the responsible minister decided that was how she would handle the process, and she won Scottish Politician of the Year as a result of getting this Parliament to vote unanimously for her legislation at the end of the stage three process because of the way in which she handled that process. And that's the last time I'm going to be nice on the record about my friend Jean Freeman. But so I think, you know, I think you can. There's a serious point here, which is that that whether you call it pre-legislative scrutiny or not, you can have effective pre-legislative scrutiny if the minister responsible for the bill comes to the committee that's doing the stage one work with that kind of frame of mind. Another example of where it went well was the hate crime bill. I mean, one of the reasons why we were able to make so many changes to the hate crime bill is because the minister responsible for it knew that he was going to have to make changes to it. That's the current First Minister, of course, Hamza Yousaf. And I think the legislative process that led to the enactment of the Hate Crime Act was really impressive. Was really good. I would say that, wouldn't I? Because I was involved
and
in
I
it.
Wouldn't.
But the no, I think your concerns about the Hate Crime Bill are not about the process. They are about the substance of what was actually in the legislation, which is a different issue. And I didn't vote for the legislation either. But we're talking about process and committees and pre-legislative scrutiny. I think a lot can be done by committees in this parliament when it is understood that bills are not the last word and that the government isn't necessarily dug in, or whoever's proposing the bill, whether it might be a private member's bill, that whoever's proposing the bill, whether it's a minister or any other member of the Scottish Parliament, isn't so dug in and committed to every clause and every provision, or even every aspect of policy that is reflected in that legislation. I think you can have really effective, you know, stage one scrutiny. It doesn't always happen, but it can happen.
Thank you.
My observation on the hate crime legislation, and not to dwell on personal grief, there's a difference between somebody listening to you and actually paying attention and changing. I think you're right. If you can, you know, if your pre-legislative work is done early enough where it's not regarded as a disaster if you've changed your position. When I took through legislation back in the day when there weren't very many ministers, the deputy ministers, it was their job to go to committee and to work through and to feedback. You're not going to win that one. We're going to have to shift on that. And, you know, I took through quite complicated legislation and would say, for example, I never lost an amendment. Now, by saying I never lost an amendment, what I meant was we'd made the changes before I was going to lose the amendment. So there's a kind of a flexibility that's built into it, which I think is essential. And that's a mindset thing. If you set something up as a disaster, if you're beaten, you end up digging your heels in and supporting legislation that's ineffective. And there's been a couple of good examples of that, I think, in the Parliament. Yeah. And so it's just the system needs to be open to the possibility that even if you're well-intentioned, there are consequences to this that are really very poor. And I think that notion that you don't thurl yourself to something and then not contemplate the possibility there might be an unintended consequence that nobody thought of, that somebody's now flagging up to you. The last thing in those circumstances a parliament should be doing is waving that away, because somebody else will live with the consequence, even if it's not you. And I think that rigour, we should not be afraid of rigour, we shouldn't be afraid of debate, we shouldn't be afraid of... I can't think of specific examples, but I do recall way back in the day, in the very early days of the Parliament, folk coming to the committee and giving evidence and say, well, you might not have thought of this, and it's not a very huge issue, but this is going to be a problem. And as a committee, both informally, and I know this happens with government backbenchers, we would speak to a minister, and formally through the committee, you could say, you need to address this again. Nobody lost face. If you can then, you know, it's the same as like a proper stage one report with proper recommendations. Nobody loses face by accepting these recommendations. I mean, we're 25 years here. I think there's a reasonable expectation that people could be mature. There's plenty of things we can have a ding-dong battle about, not about something like this, where, you know, digging of heels into legislation where other people will live with the consequences is something that, you know, good parliamentarians should resist, I think.
Do that, as convener's pre-printed bit at the top of the script. I am conscious of time. anything else? Anne, do you want to come in? And I know that Stephen has a comment to Anne.
Yeah, thanks very much. And it's good to see you both back. It's been a long time, but it's good to have you back. I've just got a couple of remarks here, a couple of questions. Joanne, I think you said in your opening remarks that in times of crisis, we can't act quickly enough to hold ministers and Cabinet Secretary to account, unlike Westminster. How could we make that better, and what's holding us back from, if there's a crisis happening, how do we make sure that we can get them in as soon as possible? Looking at work committee workload and all that, but should there be a process to call them into committee to question them? And how would that work?
Well, that, in a sense, is just a process question, and it's a matter maybe for discussion with clerks. One of the things, again, the Ken McIntosh group looked at was the possibility of committees meeting at the same time as the chamber. I can't see why that's a problem if it's, you know, a debate which is, there's not going to be a division. And frankly, if we were capable of people sitting at home on Zoom being engaged, we should probably cope with people being in committee at the same time. That would open up time, but there's a question of resource there. And in a sense, that provision is much more about the public. You see the post office crisis. We've got the guy that's been sacked is in front of a committee. That doesn't, has never happened here. And I think, people might have, and that is a place where a committee has afforded a platform for people who have got questions. And that public role, I think, is probably quite important. How you actually do it, is something that needs to be speak to professional admin expertise. But wanting to do it, I think, is actually quite important. You know, it's like the only place in the universe where the thing that's been discussed everywhere is not being discussed as in the Parliament, because we are still having... This used to drive me bananas back in the day when we would be having a three-hour debate about whatever, when the rest of the world was going to hell in a handcart. And we didn't seem to be capable of saying, well, you know what, let's find a way of just putting that to one side or cutting that debate, having an honesty about what, you know, providing five speakers on something where we can all agree with each other for 3 hours is a waste of time and energy as well. So there is an element about people across parties having to be, I think, being pretty rigorous about saying, you know, that's an indulgence. Mm-hmm. We've got this other stuff that we need to talk about. But again, you would have to have respect for the professional administrators who are managing that process. You don't want it just simply to be either the committees or the Parliament basically being buffeted by whatever's going to be on the 6 o'clock news either.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I mean, your inquiry is about the effectiveness of committees, right? But I absolutely understand that. But the really ineffective bit of this Parliament is not the committees, it's the Chamber. For all of the reasons and more that Joanne talks about. The committees are much more effective than the Chamber.
Okay.
We had a very interesting iterative report about the Chamber and the procedures there, and it is a journey. Say no more than that at the moment.
Level of there'd be nowhere to hide. If you're in a committee and I've been that soldier, you're sitting there, you're going to get asked another question and another question. Whereas we formalise it so much in the Chamber, if you just go blah, blah, blah for long enough, the clock's run down and the world has moved on. Not that I would ever have done that run down the clock thing, but anyway, that's why the committees need to take even more seriously the capacity and opportunity and power they have to bring a government minister in and be relentless with them, because there isn't any, you can't just refer to your notes when there's somebody's got you in their sights.
Thanks very much for that. And the other thing as well, and I think you touched on this as well, Joanne, it was like, do we think that we always have the same people in to give witnesses to the same committee? I know I was on the Equalities Committee for 4 years and I knew exactly who was going to be in front of me every other week. But we never heard the voices of Wee Betty, Faye, Broomhill or whatever. So, and I know we're trying to do this better in the Parliament, but how can we as committees actually listen to what people are saying that they want us to do and their views on certain criteria that we are looking at, especially in things like equalities, finance, housing and local government, because a lot of these people feel sort of too far away from the committee, but we need to hear those voices in order for us to make good legislation and put forward good reports to the government.
One of the things that committees can do, and indeed one of the things that committees do, is instead of waiting for people to come here, go and see them. So again, when I was on the Social Security Committee, we went to job centres and talked to people who were, you know, claiming universal credit. We didn't wait for them to come to us, we went to see them. And I think that I would encourage committees to think more creatively and to think more about that. Of course, there are budget implications. But look, all parliaments, committees in all parliaments, struggle with the problem of the usual suspects. Mm-hmm. And there are, you know, deeply embedded, entrenched kind of lobby interests and voices that represent those lobby interests that come before committees year in, year out. And it's not just the gender balance that needs to be thought about in terms of, you know, committee witnesses, it's frequency. And you might even want to have a quota that once you've appeared in front of a committee, you know, a couple of times in a session, that's it. We'll try and hear from somebody else. Because, you know, I mean, obviously one would want to make exceptions to that, especially for former members of the Scottish Parliament. But no, seriously, I mean, the problem that Annie has landed on is a very real one. And, you know, I know that the clerks that I worked with worked very hard to try not just to go back to the usual suspects. But there's a reason why the usual suspects become the usual suspects. And that's because they're good at doing what committees need. You know, you don't want lectures from your witnesses, even when they're professors. You want evidence that you can use, right? And not everybody has the communication skills that allow them to convert their lived experience or their professional expertise into something which is usable by a committee, given all of the other constraints on your time. So usual suspects become usual suspects, not just because we're all very lazy and we like hearing from the same people all the time, but because some people are good at helping committees do their work and be more effective. But it's a problem that we need to be mindful of and working to kind of push back on all of the time.
I think the usual suspects themselves have changed a bit as well. I think one of the observations I would make from, again, this very long time when I was here, even more ancient than I normally feel, but that organisations who were engaging with the Parliament, whether it was charities or very powerfully in the early days, groups around learning disability, had really powerful things to say. But I suspect if you look at these organisations, a lot of them now will now be employing comms experts. So your usual suspect is somebody who's developed an expertise in communicating as opposed to being the families of a learned disabled child who, in the very early days, for example, in education, one of the early bills in education, where they won an argument around presumption of inclusion. Now, I don't think, it didn't feel at the time as if it was professional communicators. It was very powerful. It was families, parents, so on that were speaking. That professionalism has not just been about who we're asking to speak, but the organisations themselves have felt the need to engage in a particular way, which I think can be a problem. And I would reiterate the point that Adam's made about being creative about going out and speaking to people and taking your evidence in a different way. And I did make the point earlier about groups and organisations that are fully funded by the Scottish Government. Two things that has been suggested. First, that should be clear, that you don't use as validation for your position the organisation that you're funding to validate your position. But also that there perhaps should be an accountability of these organisations if they're funded in that way. Is there a process in the Parliament for bringing these groups in to talk about what they do? Because a lot of what they will do will be very good. But to what extent are they constrained? And certainly in my experience, we took evidence, for example, in the Education Committee from Education Scotland, SQA, which was a joy. And I can remember other members, and I wouldn't have said this, but they felt that this was happening every year and the same frustrations and nothing really changed. So the extent to which there has to be a kind of attention, a pressure around that process as well, it's not to say that you shouldn't do it, but that there should be a degree of scepticism or challenge by committee members around that as well. I think anything that feels like a committee is doing it by rote, this is the month that we see X, then you're missing the point of what the committee might be able to do.
I've got one other question, convener, and I was going to come on to the government funding bit because I think it is important that if they are coming to committee, that they are up front and maybe there's a declaration they make at the beginning if they're given a witness statements or they're contributing, just to say that they are fully funded by the Scottish Government. The last one for me, and it was something that, having been back now a second time, I've dealt with one on the way in, one on the way in and one on the way out, legacy reports. And I think it's one of Joanne's colleagues, Mary Fee, was on the Equalities Committee. And when I came in 2016, there was a legacy report on Gypsy Travellers. I think when Mary left in 2021, there was a legacy report on Gypsy Travellers. And I'm sure there will be another one when we go in 2026. So how can committees look at the legacy reports and actually go back and see, and we should be able to go back and see what the government's doing, because we've given them the report, they've seen the legacy report, but we still seem to get the same questions every time Parliament changes. And I just don't know whether, is it valuable? And it's only, is it only valuable if we actually properly scrutinise it and do something with it on the first session that the committee gets reconstituted?
I think it depends on what the legacy report is saying, Annie. So the legacy report that my clerks prepared on my committee's behalf when I left as the convener of the Justice Committee was that the principal point, as far as I recall, was that the Justice Committee doesn't have any time to do anything apart from look at government bills. Because it was, you know, it was big bill after big bill after big bill that was coming to the Justice Committee. But the action on that doesn't rest with the Justice Committee. It probably doesn't even rest with the government. It rests with the people who are sitting around the table at the beginning of a new parliament, designing what committee structure that parliament is going to have and how many committees. And I know that one of the things that happened in this parliament that wasn't the case in the parliament in which I served is that there are now two Justice Committees, one on criminal justice and one on civil justice. Maybe that was because of what we said in the legacy report. Maybe it wasn't. I have no idea. It's not always that it's not always going to be the case that the actions that the points you make in a legacy report are points that a committee can deal with. They might be a set of issues for somebody else. If you have the same substantive policy area being kind of just kicked into the grass by Parliament after Parliament, then that's a failure of political will. Just because there is, for whatever set of reasons, there just is not the political will to address it. We all know that it's an issue that needs to be addressed, but none of us want to do it. And it doesn't matter what committee structure you have. That's not a structural problem. That's not a systemic problem. That's a political problem.
And let me just add on to that as well. So committees meet once a week. We sitting days Tuesday to Thursday. And we do have a lot of legislation that comes in front of us. We do have legacies that we want to look at. We have things that come up and we want to do our own sessions on it. We want to interrogate people or whatever. I don't think we have enough time in committees to do all that, especially Thursday morning committees when we do need to stop. And I know, Joanne, you were saying like Ken McIntosh had looked at committees sitting at the same time. I just feel you get sort of quite frustrated when you are doing the same thing over and over again. And you don't get to go on work planning days, business planning days for committee. And sometimes we never get to the real bit that we want to do. So should we do committees Monday to Friday? And the Monday to Friday, could those be days that we could be out and about in the community to do a bit of evidence gathering or what? Or do we still keep to the structure Tuesday to Thursday on sitting days? And I know that's... I'm just wanting your thoughts on it, that's all.
Well, I mean, I would just... the problem is that the committees are slotted around the chamber, not the other way around. And I would just turn it upside down.
Right.
And I would say the least important thing that happens in this building is what happens in the chamber. Because most of it's scripted, most of it leads to nothing, most of it's not even... Most people on the outside don't pay any attention. It matters much less than you think it matters when you're an MSP. Right. Mm-hmm. When you're an MSP, you think that the chamber is the kind of the heart of the thing. It's not. If chamber business was at the convenience of the committees rather than committee business being at the convenience of the chamber, I think we'd have a much more effective parliament without sitting on Mondays and Fridays.
Can I just make a couple of points? First of all, on the question, forgive me, can go back to this around funded groups. I think it should be transparent. I think what has changed, I mean, when we were in government, we funded organisations to challenge what we were doing. It never occurred to me, for example, that these organisations would just do my bidding. I used to go to, maybe it was just me, go to conference and get kicked up and down the room by whatever, you know, housing organisation or women's organisations, and be anxious and worried about actually going. So there's a cultural thing that has shifted there. So it's not so much that they are funded. But if their funding then directs what they are able to say about a piece of legislation, I really don't want to know that the group that has been funded by the government 100% agrees with the government and that that has given any validity and nobody else is given a space in it. So that it's not always the case, but I think it is sometimes the case. On the question of legacy reports, I think committees need to be serious about what it is they actually want. Don't just give us it or... They shouldn't just give a big list of all the things. It would be really good if somebody else did next time round. What were the things that were most frustrating to committee members? Mm-hmm. And make that your legacy and make that a pressure point. I mean, you talked about gypsy travellers. I actually ended up at one point while I was a minister being responsible for gypsy travellers, and we set up a, because again, going to committee, I was going to get grief, we set up a working group. It was very effective. Now, there's a question whether if you keep developing good policy and it's never implemented, that's not about either legacy, it's not about what happens in here, it's an incapacity of organisation to make real in the world what the policy debate is. And I think that, of course, is, you know, so that I think legacy should be taken seriously. Committees need to look at it when they're reconvening and have respect for it. But I suspect in that example, less is more. The last point I would make round, another point really, round the role of committees. I think too much or not enough time is taken, for example, in secondary legislation. I used to get into trouble because I had questions. And I said, well, sorry, boring you, but this is our job as legislators. And the danger is, now, again, I've probably been there, where, well, it's only secondary legislation, we can get that past the committee quite easily. I think people need to be very alive. That quite important decisions can get made around secondary legislation. And so you need to have a committee and support from clerks that's fleet of foot in that regard. And the final point, that around time, I think if what you're doing matters, then the time needs to be found. And clearly the balance, I think Adam's completely right, the balance is not right at the moment, where you can have a couple of hours of wearisome, tedious consensus around X, when in fact this is a really important issue that needs to get wrestled with, and the committee is the best place to do that because it's a different kind of forum. I would, even although latterly I was a list member, I would hold on to the notion of the importance, particularly, it used to be it wasn't two constituency days, it was one constituency day, but you did parliamentary work in a different way. I can't remember which was Monday or the Friday. So I think it's entirely reasonable that a committee could be doing work on a Monday if it involved going out and engaging with folk. Yeah. But I think that notion for getting the balance right in terms of your work as a parliamentarian, being serious about your local community constituency work, should be recognised in the parliamentary timetable.
Thanks very much, Convener. Thanks very much.
Thank you. And again, I'm conscious of time. Stephen, can I...
Yeah, I'll,
with a conscience of time, I'm afraid.
You've said that three times in relation to my section, so that's okay. I get the message. I've got a concern about power and the power imbalance between the executive and this parliament. There's been a number of references to the feature of this parliament was to be its powerful committees. They were to be in place of a second chamber. We've obviously, I mean, so let me challenge something that Adam said. He was critical of the scrutinising powers of the Parliament in relation to this power balance, but then you were quite full of praise about process. But a process that leads to law being designated ultra vires, surely that's a failure in the process.
No, I don't see it like that. I think it's baked into the devolution settlement, right? I mean, this is not a sovereign parliament. It's not a parliament of unlimited competence. It is a parliament of limited competence, and its competences are limited by law. And the only people who can ever have an authoritative word about whether those competences have been exceeded or not is a Supreme Court. Not even a law professor is a more important voice in that argument than a Supreme Court judge. So, no, I don't think it's a failure of devolution at all. I think this is an example of devolution working. Now, you might not like devolution, you might want something else, but look, we have devolution for the time being, right? And devolution means that we have multiple parliaments in the United Kingdom. They can't all do everything that they want to do. Some of them have limits imposed upon them by the law, and those limits must be tested and ultimately enforced by courts.
But there must be something amiss in the process if during legislative process the parliament, the committees, whatever it is, doesn't come up against this idea that actually this is probably outside of the scope of the authority of the parliament.
Well,
surely that is a process-related defect.
I see the force of that argument, but I'm not sure that... Well, first of all, I would say that even though the number of cases that the Supreme Court has invalidated provisions of Acts of the Scottish Parliament has increased of late and not decreased of late, it's still tiny, right? So most legislation passed by this Parliament is not challenged by the Supreme Court, and even if it is challenged by the Supreme Court, it's not necessarily invalidated by the Supreme Court. And there are you know, very well-known examples of where the Supreme Court has taken a view about legislation which is different from the view that this Parliament took, not because the Parliament ignored the question of competence, but because the Supreme Court just took a different view. So the Continuity Bill would be a really good example. I mean, well, there's a lot of debate in this place in 2018 about whether the Continuity Bill was within competence or out with competence, not least because the then presiding officer certified that in his view it was not within competence, but the Parliament proceeded to enact the legislation anyway, and then it went to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court invalidated certain provisions of the bill on grounds very different, actually, from the grounds that the presiding officer had identified as his reasons for thinking. So, you know, the outcome was that the legislation, large parts of the legislation, were invalidated. But the process was that Parliament enacted legislation fully with it in mind that we were running up against the limits of competence. But the ultimate decision-maker on this was not for us, it was for the Supreme Court. That, to my mind, is devolution working. Devolution within the law working, and not a failure of the parliamentary process. I don't think, Joanne said in her, I said it would be a challenge to find a difference between the two of us, but the one difference between the two of us is that Joanne intimated in an earlier remark that it was some kind of embarrassing failure to lose a case in the Supreme Court. It's not. I mean, the definition of a case that goes to the Supreme Court is a definition that's plausibly arguable either way. Otherwise, what's it doing in the Supreme Court? Right, it's no embarrassment to lose in the Supreme Court. It's a reflection of the fact that within a parliamentary democracy that is committed to the rule of law, powerful courts, appeal courts, are there to ensure that even institutions as prestigious as this one act within and not beyond the limits of their legal competences. I think that's perfectly normal.
Right.
Can I just say what is embarrassing is if you're told that people have argued that there is an issue with this legislation, and it's been waved away. So it's not that the Supreme Court found it, it was that they already knew and chose not to pay any attention to it. And I think, you know, we all know that there have been controversial...
Because of time, and try and draw us back to committees. I'm just very conscious of time, and I know there's still another member.
Yeah, I
interesting as this discussion is.
I think it does relate to the nature of committees, particularly in relation to their legislative scrutinising responsibilities. And so, very briefly then, to please the convener, who I like to please. I was a member of the Select Committee in the House of Commons. The chair of that committee was Rachel Reeves. And Rachel was a brilliant convener because she said at the outset, in chairing the meeting, when people come in front of the committee and they leave, they need not to have thought once about what the party affiliation of the person in the committee was. They shouldn't be able to tell the difference between us. Now, that is not the case, clearly, from your evidence this morning, from your reflections. That is not the case in our parliament. I want to understand why that is the case. Is it a reflection on the calibre of our MSPs?
I think it's partly. Yeah. It's partly a reflection of political culture in Scotland, which has become, over the course particularly of the last 10 or 12 years, much more dominated by party loyalty than perhaps it was in the first period of devolution. It's partly also a function of size. Now, I am not in favour of the Scottish Parliament growing in terms of its number of members. I think there should be fewer elected politicians in Scotland, not more elected politicians in Scotland, with all respect to those in the room who have been elected. But I do think that the fact that it is easier in a Commons of 650 members to be a sort of maverick and to make a sort of career as a maverick and to make that career on the committee corridor without worrying too much about what happens in the chamber, that is harder here because there are fewer people to start with. So it's partly a function of calibre, partly a function of size, and partly a function of the changed nature, I think, changed nature of Scottish political culture, which has become much more driven by party loyalty. It is beginning to, that last point, it is beginning to break down, and not before time. So I'm optimistic. I'm always optimistic, as you know. I'm optimistic that things will get better rather than worse.
Well, I think it's worth saying that you can't ignore the fact that for the last how many years, every discussion has been a proxy for a big discussion around the Constitution. So even if you don't particularly agree with a policy, you don't want to be seen to be on the wrong side of that big divide in terms of your own party and divide. And I think that has concentrated people's minds, it's focused people's minds, it's maybe inhibited people's capacity to disagree because it's then given more significance than otherwise. And I also think party discipline in a multi-party system devised by PR, then your rebellion makes an awful lot more of a difference. You're going to change. We learned this very early on, where there was an accidental rebellion, if I recall, on something to do with ferries in the very first parliament, where people thought, well, we can't possibly support this. And all of a sudden discovered they had beaten their own government by accident on something they hadn't quite realised it was quite such a serious matter. So I think that's part of it as well. And I think that's a long time. The point, just to finish the point round, that if you were asking a lot of people around organisations and people I work with now about the faults of the Parliament, is that we've had to have grassroots organisations develop to do the work that they thought a committee would ask. So women's organisations, there's a burgeoning women's movement again in Scotland, which has almost entirely come out of a frustration that the system is not asking the questions that they want asked, and they're not demanding answers that they want answered. And so there's a whole structure of people doing really serious policy work, and their frustration is they're doing it on a voluntary basis when the system should be doing that. That's a challenge.
Is that a reflection of calibre?
Well, I can't. I mean, don't ask me to judge.
Adam was only too happy to say. Do you have a view?
Well, how does calibre? What is? It's not to
well, because outside of Parliament, a lot of people think we've got too many career politicians.
Let me put it this way: I don't think the capacity for people to be serious about their jobs remains the same. The reward for being serious about your job and independent of what the parliamentary process is and your leadership and your party and all the rest of it is maybe different. And that's why you have to take it back to basics about, ultimately, it's about elected members being serious about their job and stop, you know, kind of outsourcing some your thinking to somebody else. Take it seriously.
I said the Parliament have continually expressed concerns, quite publicly aired, that too many of our parliamentarians have only ever lived in the bubble of politics. And therefore, their ability to do what you've said is impinged by the fact that they have no hinterland.
Well, and it can also be that the consequence of disagreement is massive. I mean, So if somebody had said to me, when the Parliament was established, my big thing about the Parliament ultimately was it wasn't something I, in my youth, was in favour of, because I thought Scotland's a diverse country, stop pretending all Scots are the same as each other, coming from the kind of background I did. However, seeing how distant Westminster was from people's lived experience, the kids that I was teaching in class, I believed you bring power closer to people. I have concerns, as maybe some can develop at another point, about the system now sitting atop that. But we have created jobs, we have created roles, we've created functions for people to do that job, but you've lost that connection. And now, it's nothing inevitable about it, because it's about how people do their jobs. Mm-hmm. It's about how seriously the idea that any politician would write to somebody and say, I'm not meeting with you because I don't agree with you. I find that astounding. I just find that astounding, because what are you fearful of, that you're going to maybe learn something you hadn't thought about before? So I think that notion that actually some of this is not legislatable or regulatory, can't regulate for the mindset people have. But it doesn't mean that inevitably, just simply because the folk who are in here came from a different journey from mine, that they haven't got the capacity to do that. That would also be wrong.
Self-perpetuating culture, that's the problem.
So I would just say on this question of Calabre, I mean, I would say that Calabre is a problem, but it's not the cause of the problem, it's a symptom. The underlying cause is the question of political culture, and in particular party political culture. Who do parties want to be their representatives? Because parties don't regard you or us as representatives of the people, they regard them as representatives of themselves, right? And so who does the party leadership, who does the party hierarchy want to encourage to become an MP or an MSP? That's the underlying, I think, cause of the problem. So focusing on the calibre of individuals. It's a bit like, you know, playing the person rather than the ball. It is part of the problem, but it's not. It's a symptom of the problem rather than its underlying cause. Its underlying cause is political culture.
I'm going to slightly draw a line under it, but interesting that in this, of course, the 25th year of this Parliament, much of these discussions, I think, are very worthy and need to take place, particularly this year. But I'm going to drag us back to committees, and I'm going to look to Ivan to see if there's anything that you'd like to cover as we move
thank
to
you
the
very much,
last part of it.
Yeah, welcome to witnesses this morning, and thanks for your open dialogue and wide-ranging input to this very important subject. I was quite taken, Professor Tompkins, by your outline and your introduction about the role of the Parliament and the three functions there. I think that's a very helpful way to think about it. I'm going to slightly take issue with you on one aspect, and I'd like to explore that a wee bit more. You said, and you both said, that the role of the committee wasn't to debate issues. I understand what you mean in terms of a grandstanding opportunity to make political points, but I think that there is an issue perhaps round about the role of committees and allowing issues to be raised that otherwise wouldn't be raised. And I'd like to kind of get your reflections on that. The Petitions Committee clearly is one structure manifestation of that, but clearly in all committees the opportunity arises there, because I'm certainly taken by the fact when you meet people or encounter people outside the Parliament, if they're coming to give evidence to a committee, for them that's a big deal, and the fact they're engaging with the process through that. And then I suppose the follow-on from that is quite an existential question, but what is the outcome then of that? Because is it just that people will come in, make their views known to committee as evidence or a part of inquiry, whatever, but then it doesn't necessarily go anywhere. And I think that come back to the point that Annie Wells made on legacy reports, and certainly me coming back to committees after a five-year absence as a minister, and you're like, oh, you're still talking about the same things you were 5 years ago, and the same people are coming in and we're asking the same questions, and what's actually changed. So I suppose as a follow-up, then what does change as a consequence of that?
So when I said it's not the role of committees to debate matters of public interest, that all of the work in that sentence is being done by the word debate, right? It's not the function of committees to stage debates. It's not the function of committees to deliberate in that kind of way that happens in the chamber. It's absolutely the role of committees to bring issues in from the outside to Parliament's attention, issues of public concern. And it's of course much easier for committees to do that than it is for the chamber to do that, because of the issues that I was talking about in response to Evelyn's questions about what makes an effective inquiry, what makes an effective committee. The power that committees have is the power to take evidence, and the power to choose who to take evidence from. And absolutely. I mean, I wasn't meaning to imply by my opening remarks, Ivan, that I thought that committees should somehow be kind of immunised from or insulated from matters of public debate. But it's not the function of committees to debate in the way that it is the function of, you know, MSPs in the chamber to debate. That's really what I tried to say. That's really what I meant by what I said there in my opening remarks. In terms of your more, as it were, existential question, what's the outcome? Again, that's the responsibility of committees, isn't it? Like, you know, so we've talked about this, all morning. You can take whatever evidence you want, but what do you do with it, right? And do you use it in a way which adds value to the parliamentary conversation, if I can put it like that, or do you diminish its value by inserting it into a part of the conversation that's already there, as if nothing of value has been added by speaking to all of these people from the outside who you wouldn't otherwise have spoken to? And that's always the choice that committees have, it seems to me. And I think both Joanne and I have been giving you all morning examples of where we think committees have done that job well in this Parliament, by adding value rather than simply replicating things which would already have been said, even if the committee had not bothered to get out of bed that morning.
On the question of issues that wouldn't be raised elsewhere, and really kind of reflect maybe the point that was made earlier, there's a danger that the system simply, you know, people lobby for things to go in the manifesto published and it says that, and then you spend the next 4 years talking about those things, and it's not really relating in any way to the priorities of constituents. I would probably draw the parallel, for example, the way my own attitude to surgery worked, particularly when I was a constituency member, that you try to help somebody with a problem. Try to understand what is it in the system that's caused the problem, as opposed to the individual experience. Is there something in the system that's caused that problem? Then take that into the political process. And I think that is, you know, people doing their job. Now, the best comparator with that in the Parliament, I think, is the Public Petitions Committee. The Public Petitions Committee, we would routinely deal with those petitions which were on the big issues of the day, which were being argued about all the time. The constitutional question is a good one. The Public Petitions Committee did not spend time on that because we knew it was going to be discussed elsewhere. You discuss the issues, and I think that's a test for a committee. Are we looking at this because nobody else is looking at it? We're looking at it in a different way. And it's not lived experience, it's anecdote. The danger with lived experience is, I know this really poor person, this really terrible thing happened to them. Isn't that a shame? If you say, well, that has happened to them, and we can understand the barriers that have caused that, the institutions, the systems that have created that, and we're going to do something about that, that is worthy of a committee's time. And I think the Public Petitions Committee is a good example of that, stripping out, being honest. We're going to be debating the Constitution in the chamber, so let's talk about other things that also matter. And I think that would be quite a reasonable kind of test. The point you make is actually that, yeah, you're still asking that question. I went away from this committee 4 years ago and you're still wrestling with it. Well, that's because some questions are really tough, but sometimes it's because you can get locked into a system. So I think the challenge, I guess, political for all of us, but particularly for committees, is not just to buy into what the usual suspects politically want to talk about. There's a huge opportunity and a privilege to talk about things that they don't. And we gave a couple of examples earlier. The mesh one is a classic example of an injustice done to women. By sheer force of their campaigning activity, brought it into the public domain. But once it was there, you saw a whole series of politicians and committees really doing their job seriously, and just refused to let it go, no matter what people. It was getting difficult and awkward, and yes, it went on for a while, but it was because there was all sorts of strands to it, and I think that's a good model. You talk about things that are not going to get talked about otherwise. And the point I was making earlier about having a political debate, what was the way in which the committee was in the early days used, where you told a journalist, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to say X. And then you go in and say it, and then you go back out and you get reported having said it. That was bouncing. It was like a trampoline effect. That's not serious. And I think a lot of that has gone. But it is all that time and energy and seriousness that committee members bring, it's a way of thinking about bring it to bear on issues I've not already, that they might not get the same focus as otherwise, because I think it is that kind of relentlessness that a committee can offer that a parliament debate can't do, a chamber debate can't do.
Thanks. One other point on the second of your points, Adam, holding government to account. We've had a lot of good discussion, I think, this morning about the value of committees and inquiries and raising issues, evidence, legislation, and the two-way street that can operate effectively there. I don't know if there's anything you want to highlight as a good example of committees holding government to account.
It's harder to think of good examples of that in my view. I mean, I suppose the Finance Committee did a lot of that, right? I mean, because the Finance Committee was a committee that was not overwhelmed with legislation. From time to time, there would be legislation, of course, and every year there was the budget, which, as I said before, is a form of legislation but has its own bespoke procedure. And quite a lot of the Finance Committee's time was taken to talking to finance ministers, particularly the CAPSEC, obviously, about budgetary matters. Whether the committee ever managed to make much difference to government policy, given that that is an area where it's very, very difficult for any kind of cabinet secretary any finance secretary to come in front of that committee and say, well, I'm not really quite sure about my tax policy yet. I'm open to the committee's views. That's a bit politically unrealistic, even by my standards, right? How you would measure the effectiveness of accountability in a context like that, I'm not quite sure, to be honest. I think it's quite difficult. The best examples I can think of are all about the way in which responsible ministers handled legislation. In terms of accountability for actions, policies and decisions, I think this Parliament's got a lot of work to do.
Thanks. And my final point, I think Joanne's already kind of commented on this, was round about elected conveners and your thoughts on that.
With the caveat that it should be, you should be elected by your peers. Because the danger is that you say, well, you've got a majority, so we'll choose the weakest candidate from amongst the opposition. You know, forgive me for being thinking bad thoughts, but you can see how processes, a well-intentioned process, can be distorted. And we've seen this a wee bit, I would argue, around some of the decisions around presiding officers and so on, that the majority party gets to choose who Labour's person is going to be in the Finance Committee. Well, I think we could see what or the convener would be. So I think it would need to be... It's something... Clearly, if it was easy, it would have been sorted by now. But I do think that sense... I mean, and we are seeing it. I'm noticing that the convener of the Finance Committee has been seeing quite a lot of quite strong stuff, as far as I can see. And we know that some committees... The community is absolutely charged with doing that kind of job. So, it's, these things are there. Yeah. But there's not an easy fix to it. I'd go back to the point. I do think elected conveners, but you need to strip out the payroll vote. Otherwise, it just gets completely distorted. But that sense of parliamentarians of their own role, which is that I'm not here simply just to sit and nod my head, I'm equally not here just simply to kind of constantly... I'm as tribal as they get, so my tribal role is only part of my job. Actually, it's a kind of a seriousness. There's lots to be gained by parliamentarians understanding that is just an important job in itself. I at one point suggested that parties should not get short money if there was evidence that they were whipping committee members or disciplining committee members for how they're conducting themselves in committee. That's probably taking a step too far. But culturally, I think we should be saying to parties, have the space and confidence in your members that when they go into committee, they follow the evidence. And nobody, how could anybody be the worse for that? But the caveat in that is you need to make sure the evidence that people are presented with has not been filleted before you actually get to committee. The committees need to have confidence to hear from more than people's going to agree with them as well.
So Adam, on that?
One of the things I said at the beginning was that we don't elect governments in this country. Governments emerge out of and are accountable to the parliaments that we do elect. And I think it's really important always to bear in mind that it is the government that is accountable to the parliament and not the parliament that is accountable to the government. And I think that this parliament doesn't always bear that properly in mind in terms of the way in which the bureau functions, in terms of the way in which elections for PO are run informally. And I don't think this is about rules. I think it's about culture. And I think if you had a parliament of 129 MSPs, or even if you had a parliament of 100 MSPs who thought that their job was... to hold the government to account, with 29 MSPs perhaps taking a different view, then you'd have a different political culture and you'd have different structures and different procedures, and it might even be that you would end up with less legislation being quashed by the Supreme Court as a result. I don't know. But I think that, I said all of that stuff at the beginning because I think I think where you end up is determined by where you start from. And if you start from the right principles and you absolutely understand that it is the constitutional function of a parliament to hold the government to account and never the other way around, then you wouldn't necessarily end up after 25 years where we've ended up here.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for a very interesting morning, very thought-provoking. I know we have an offer, if we have additional questions, to contact you. I was just going to rather... use the convener's privilege, particularly on the last point that you raised, Adam, that the three criteria the Bureau should take in recommending to the Chamber committee members is, as we've already discussed, the party balance, but also the interest of a member to serve on a committee and also the member's qualification and experiences and as indicated by that member to serve on a committee. So I think you've raised a lot of questions. Can I thank you both very much for your contributions this morning? And I am sure you will follow our inquiry with interest, which is also good because it means we're being held to account by those who were formerly here but now outside, but whose view and opinions are most welcome. Can I thank you very much? And can I now move this into private?
Thank you.